I want to greet you today, and I want you to give me your undivided attention for about the next 25 minutes or so. This may be the most important message that I have shared this year with the worldwide audience of Manifest. This message will actually be in two parts, this week and also next week, but it'll have a different title next week. In the next few moments, I want to share with you a vision that a minister had several years ago that is absolutely coming to pass. The second thing I want to do in this message is build a foundation for you of what the real spiritual warfare actually is and how decisions are made in the spirit realm against leaders and against people in the body of Christ. And hopefully I'll be able to share with you toward the conclusion the greatest danger we have in the time of the end, and it probably is not what you think it is. Now, I've often wondered, if we could look into the spirit world, and that is the world of angels and demons, what would we actually see? Well, I'm going to tell you what we would see based on the book of Revelation chapter 12, verses 7 through 8. We would see a spiritual warfare taking place in the heavens. And this is just one verse that identifies it. When there was war in heaven, Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and that, of course, the dragon is Satan here. And the dragon fought and his angels and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. What we see on earth is just one picture of what is happening behind the scenes. As a matter of fact, when you go into the Bible and you begin to study in the scripture, some of the things that begin to happen in relation to angels and demons battling for the will of God, or battling, let's put it this way, so I want to correct myself. Angels that battle to perform the will of God and demonic spirits that battle to hinder the word of God and the will of God from being done. Here's what you begin to see. First of all, there was the setup of a death in the Old Testament. Ahab was a wicked king. God wanted him to be removed and be replaced. And so the prophet Micaiah was looking into the heavens in a vision, and he saw angels on one side of the throne of God, angels on the other side. He called them the host of heaven. And there was a decision made of how to trick Ahab to go to battle, and he would die in the battle. 400 false prophets on earth told him to go to battle and he would win. And only one prophet of God who saw the vision said, if you go, you're not going to make it out alive. And it was a setup of a death which was being actually discussed in the court of heaven. And then we find that there is a great story in the book of Job, especially chapter 1 and chapter 2, where the sons of God, the B'nai Elohim, which are the angels, were coming before the throne of God for a conference meeting. And Satan was among them. I'll explain that in a moment. And Satan went to God and began to falsely assault and accuse Job of being someone who was serving God for the ulterior motive. And as you know, Job lost his 10 children, their home. He lost all of his livestock, and he actually lost his health. The only thing Satan could not do was take his life. So we see how in the heavenlies, angels are involved in sentencing people at times, evil people to death. For example, in Acts chapter 12, an angel of God smote Herod in his intestines, and he died with worms, according to Josephus, in 5 days. And then we see that Satan, on the other hand, we flip this around, is out to destroy the lives of people. And he does it through different methods, as you can see in Job chapter 1 and chapter 2. And then there's this setup with the Apostle Paul. In 2 Corinthians 11, he lists 22 horrible things that he went through. Most of them were caused by people who were beating him, harassing him, and causing difficulties for him. But he said there was given to him a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan, to buffet him. And that word messenger of Satan there is the Greek word for angel. It was a very evil angel, directly under the command of Satan himself, who was assigned to hinder Paul in practically every place he went to. Now, if you look at Paul's situation, Job's situation, and the story about King Ahab, here's what it shows you. It shows you John 10 and 10, that the thief, and that's Satan, comes not but for to kill and to steal and to destroy. But I'm going to tell you, and the Lord shared this with me months and months ago, that the one thing that Satan despises the most, and I think the one thing that causes him to move toward a church or a ministry or leadership to try to silence them, is a word called revelation. Now, in this case, I'm not talking about prophecy preaching, like preaching from the book of Daniel, book of Zechariah, or the book of Revelation. But Paul talks about, in the New Testament, speaking by revelation. If any of you have a revelation, let it be done in such and such manner. The Greek word revelation is apokalypsis, and it means to disclose something that has been concealed. Now, here's what I want to tell you. When you talk about having a revelation, it means that you see something that you previously did not know. And you learn these things according to the Bible by the Holy Spirit, who teaches you all things. For example, there are many of you watching me right now that maybe in your earlier days, you attended a church that didn't believe in praying for the sick or didn't believe in the Holy Spirit. They didn't believe in healing. They didn't believe in miracles. But as you studied the Word, and maybe you watched Manifest, you start saying, "No, wait a minute." You may have said to your wife or husband, "This is in the Bible. Why are we doubting what God told us in the Bible?" Well, you may not realize it, but what happened to you at that moment is you received a divine revelation. I would say it this way, that the eyes of your understanding were opened. That's what Paul talked about in the New Testament. And let me share with you why Satan is so afraid of your eyes being opened. Now listen to this statement, because the revelation can absolutely change your situation. There are people who are now alive today because they received a revelation of healing. There are people on fire for God today, burning with the zeal of God, because they received a revelation of what the Holy Spirit can do for you. There are people that were bound by addictions and dying, and they received a revelation that Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil and deliver all that were oppressed of the devil, Acts 10:38. And now their life has changed. So here's what I'm telling you, that when you have a ministry, and I'm talking about a pastor, evangelist, or teacher, or you have a church that constantly has leadership that is preaching the Bible on a revelatory level, meaning it's not just a basic teaching, it's not just a feel-good teaching, it's just not a let's all sing kumbaya and clap our hands and go home. We're talking about something that when you walk out the door, you look at each other and say, "I didn't know that. That's my answer. That's what I needed to hear." That's what Satan wants to stop. So he is actually after anyone who can look at the Bible and look at the Bible and interpret the scripture and put this verse and that Greek word with that Greek word and this Hebrew word with this Hebrew word. And then that word that is being taught by that individual, whether it's a teacher, a male or female teacher, doesn't matter. The enemy wants to silence the revelation. That's why Paul said, "There was given to me a thorn in the flesh because of the abundance of the revelation." Paul got seven, he received, I should say, seven revelations that God gave him as being an apostle. Seven. He received the revelation of the rapture, 1 Thessalonians 4. He received the mystery of the resurrection of the dead in 1 Corinthians 15. He received the mystery of Israel's blindness in Romans chapter 11. Nobody knew it before he received it when he went to Mount Sinai in Arabia, this is in the book of Galatians, and spent time receiving a download from heaven or a revelation from the Lord. Now, I will say this to you. When I was 16 years of age, I began to pray that God would give me understanding of the Bible in the same manner that he gave Daniel understanding of dreams and visions in the book of Daniel. And I remember that I prayed that for 2 years, 16 to 18 years of age. And then at 18 years of age, God began to bless us with 2 and 3 week revivals, 4 week revivals. I would study. I would present something very deep from the Word. And here was my pattern. I want people to hear something, learn something, and feel something. I want them to hear the Word of God. I want them to feel the presence of God. And I want them to learn something that they may not have known before. So I was seeking the revelation of God. Well, in the 1990s, the Lord spoke to me, and I wrote a book called Unleashing the Beast. It's still available through our ministry if you'd like to get it. And in this, I had a thesis because I had sat down with a young lady in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. She was attending a revival, and we were all staying at a home, Pam and I were, and we invited her over, and she was from Persia. She was from Iran. And she said, "Do you realize that when you preached from Revelation chapter 13 on the false prophet and on the Antichrist, that you taught what I was taught growing up in Persia?" I said, "You mean they taught the Bible?" She said, "No." She says, we're an Islamic nation. And she said, everything you said, I heard growing up, but I heard it as a man who would come in the future and would be accepted by the world and would convert the world to Islam. And she took 2 days to teach me. And that's what the result of this book was. Okay, this book had information that I remember in 1991 and 92 at the International Prophetic Conference. Many of you senior citizens were there back in that day. And I was teaching this and I got up and taught it, and it was completely different from what every other speaker there was teaching. Now, because of the revelation of God in the end time, almost every prophetic preacher that I personally know believes what I taught in that book. And it's not because of my teaching, it was because it's from the Bible. It discerned the times, it put everything together. Okay, and here's what, this is the point I'm getting to. In the 1990s, after writing this book, my dad had a dream that bothered him. I found the piece of paper that this dream was written on, and there were two spirits. He saw me preaching, and there was a very large, powerful spirit and one that was half the size of the other one. And the big one was saying to the little one, how did you let him get a hold of this information? How did you let him get this? And the little one said, we tried to stop him, but we couldn't. And so this big one reached into the belly of the little one. I say the belly, into this area here, and pulled out his authority. And the little one is screaming, no, 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 don't take my authority. Don't take my authority. And then it threatened me. The big one now threatens me and says, if he uses this information against us, I'll take him out myself. And my dad saw this and he wrote it down and he came to me. He said, Perry, what are you teaching? When I told him, he said, Perry, you're going to have to surround yourself with prayer. Now, let's go ahead of time. I remember going to the Daystar Network with Marcus Lamb. And this was when it was just in Dallas, Texas. And there was one main network at that time. And it was covering the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. I was sitting at a table. I said to Marcus, let me preach on the subject of unleashing the beast. And I've got a book on it. He said, that's fine. We'll do that. Marcus was never afraid for any kind of word that was from God to go across the Daystar Network. Well, I remember sitting at a table writing and I was making notes for the night, and I got a little cramp in my back, and I stood up and stepped back, and a light, and we're talking about a major studio light. It was back in those days, they were can lights. It came loose from where it was hanging and smashed on the table. I would have been 3 seconds before that leaned over, and it would have got me on the back of the neck. They all came out. They couldn't understand what had happened. Something had come loose, and they were petrified. And they said, Perry, this could have killed you. Now, the same night I'm teaching, there is no storm, nothing happening in Dallas, no hail, no lightning, no anything. And all of a sudden the power goes out. You can't see me. Now you can hear a voice, but you can't see anything. Well, they start checking and said, what's happened? Well, back in that day, all the producers were upstairs and they were sitting here producing the program, and it was live. And there was a room there that had the power. In other words, you walk in this room and that's where all the power switches were. And listen to this. No one had been in that room, and yet they went in, and as they're checking with their flashlights, they find out that something had taken all the power switches and pulled them down. Now, what do you think about that? Can I tell you what it was? It was a 2 Corinthians chapter 12 hindering spirit attempting to hinder what God was wanting to do. Now, I'm going to tell you a story that came to me from a friend of mine called Billy Burke, a great minister of the gospel. In September of 2021, Billy was suffering with COVID. And instead of sleeping in the room with his wife, of course, he was sleeping on the couch. And he said, I got up to go to the restroom. But he said, I never made it, because as I am walking, going toward the restroom, I'm suddenly in a field. He said, now this is not a dream. This is happening. I see a vision. It's covered with mud. It's almost like a swamp. And I thought to myself, oh my goodness, what am I seeing? What in the world is this? And in the distance, he saw two very grotesque, ugly, demonic spirits. And they were carrying on a conversation with each other. Now, as he's in this swamp, and this is not a dream now, he's up. And as he's in this swamp-like muddy area, he's afraid. He thought, oh my goodness, they're going to see me. And a fear came on him, and he heard the voice of the Lord say, you can see them, but they can't see you, but I want you to listen to what they're saying. Now remember, this is September 2021. And the one said to the other one, they said, and again, these are two spirits carrying a conversation. The big one said to the smaller one, have you heard anything yet? Or the small one said to the big one, it was one of the two, have you heard anything yet? And the biggest one said this. Now listen to the statement. This big demonic prince spirit said, yes, we have, the time is starting soon to take out the leaders. The time is coming soon. It's getting ready to start to take out the leaders. And he was stunned when he heard this. And the other one said, when will it start? He says, it's going to start immediately, but wait till you hear from me. Then the other one said, do we have any names? And listen to this. And the answer, it said, the answer of the big one was, well, you wait till you hear from me because the list is being made. Now, I'm giving the very abbreviated version. Billy has more details than that, of course. But I thought, oh my goodness. So he sees this and he understands that in the kingdom of Satan, there was a strategy planned to take out the leaders of the church, and there was an actual list being made of trying to do that. Now, you and I know that as time progressed, and this happened, as a matter of fact, after that took place, one of my dear friends in town passed away with a heart attack. He just simply dropped over with a heart attack, and he went to be with the Lord. Marcus Lamb came to this town in Cleveland at the Omega Center International and preached that minister's funeral because he had been the best man in his wedding. The next thing I knew, Marcus had a heart situation, and Marcus went home to be with the Lord as well. And in one denomination, you listen to this, in one denomination, 400 preachers passed away. Some of them were bishops. In Cleveland, Tennessee, in the denomination called the Church of God, there were several of their key leaders. These are men that are voted in at council meetings every so many years to be leaders over the youth or maybe evangelism or missions. And then I start hearing of ministers passing away outside the United States. Now, I want to make sure you understand what I'm about to say right now. According to the Lord Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ still retains the keys of death and hell. Jesus said this, I am he that was dead, but behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And I have the keys of death and of hell. Now, here's what this means. And I want to go to the book of Job to explain this to you. This means that Satan cannot go in and just say, you know what? I am going to take out that person. Okay? Watch carefully because Jesus has the keys. Let me say it to you this way. There's a door in heaven. That door has to be open for you to permanently leave your spirit, your body on earth, and your soul and spirit go into heaven and remain in heaven until the resurrection. But the door does not open from the earth side. The door opens from the heaven side. So in other words, it's Jesus that says, come home. Look at these near-death experiences and notice how many people will say, I had a heart attack, I was in a car accident, I went to heaven, I saw my family. And all of them describe basically, the heaven ones do, almost the same thing. A tunnel, a light, going at great speeds to get to where they were, seeing loved ones that had passed away, seeing people that look much younger than they did in their older age when they died. And yet, the Lord Jesus will say to them, your time is not yet. You have more to do and you have to go back. And there are hundreds of true cases where this has actually happened. And so the thing that amazes me about that is that even though they had an experience of seeing the other side, Jesus still controlled when they came. My mother passed away with COVID. My mother was 80 some years of age, but I know my mother was very, very tired. She broke her wrist. She broke her ankle. She was having a tough time. And when we heard she passed away, I was rejoicing, not that she passed away. That grieved me. That was my mama. But I knew, man, her trials are over. Her spirit and soul has left her body to be absent from the bodies, to be present with the Lord. No more cares, no more pain. And she is with the spirits of those who have gone to be with the Lord. The Bible talks about paradise, the souls of men being under the altar of God, under the sea of glass in heaven. That's a whole nother message. So when you see these number of men and women of God that passed away, it was a virus that took their life in some cases. It was a pre-existing heart problem that no one knew about. My mama had that. We didn't know it. That took my mama's life. Even though she had COVID, she was recovering. So what I want to say to you is simply this. When you see people passing away, you can't say always, you can't say, well, look at the devil took their life, because Jesus has the power of death. So we have to trust God when there's been a death that we don't understand it. We don't know why. We'll understand it better by and by. But I do want to say this to you, and this is where we're going to get into next week's teaching very, very, very heavy, because next week's teaching is Christians who give Satan credibility. Don't you miss it. But here's what I want to say. Sometimes there are doors that open, and the enemy wants a door to open in your life so that he can get inside that door. When Cain was angry because Abel's offering pleased God and God was not pleased with his, God said to him, Cain, why is your countenance down? If you continue in this way, sin is crouching at the door. Now, what the enemy wants is a crack in the door to get into your life. And there are people, according to Ecclesiastes, that die prematurely. I'm writing a book on that right now, and it's called, Why Did You Leave Us So Soon? That can happen. But we have to trust God and understand that Jesus alone, for a believer, has the keys of death and hell. And Jesus alone, even with a sinner, knows when a sinner is going to pass away, because it's appointed unto men once to die, and after that, the judgment. But what I want to share with you is this idea of taking out leaders. Now, next week, I'm going to tell you how the church is falling into a trap of Satan, and they are assisting the enemy in taking down leaders. Boy, you don't want to miss this one. I've got something to offer you. Stay tuned and watch till the very end of the broadcast.
See and hear 100% proof that ancient Bible prophecies are now being fulfilled as we are racing toward the return of Christ. In Perry Stone's new DVD series, 30 Prophecies Fulfilled Since 1967, he documents amazing prophecies, some penned in Scripture thousands of years ago, that have been fulfilled beginning in 1948 to today. All are now unfolding in the nation of Israel. Perry explains how Israel is God's last day prophetic time clock, pointing to the midnight hour of the Messiah's return. During more than 40 trips to Israel, Perry has been boots on the ground, capturing firsthand when, where, and how these 30 prophecies have been and are presently being fulfilled, from the Golan Heights in the north to ancient Judea and Samaria, then south to the Judean wilderness region, including the Dead Sea. He reveals prophecies about modern weapons and wars in Israel. He includes Israeli cities and events on ancient mountains, leading you through a journey linked with predictions about the walls and gates of Old Jerusalem. Perry includes new and undeniable evidence that he has never publicly shared before. On this two DVD set, 3-hour teaching, Perry includes photographic confirmation of prophetic activity throughout Israel, verifying these end-time prophecies are being fulfilled. He affirms his evidence using biblical word studies, historical proof, providing significant visual lists during his teaching. These 3 hours are a full prophetic documentary that proves the Bible is true. 1948 was the introduction of end-time events, and 1967 was the early beginning of the end. As Rabbi Gorin stated in 1967, we have entered the seasons of the Messiah. This DVD series is a must-watch for all prophecy lovers. This teaching is also a fabulous soul-winning resource to share with prophetic skeptics, unbelievers, unsaved, and lukewarm family members and friends. The 3-hour 2 DVD series is yours for a donation of $30 or more. In addition, Perry is adding a surprise bonus audio CD with your order. Order by calling toll-free 1-888-21-BREAD. That's 1-888-212-7323, or online at perrystone.org. A video on-demand option is also available on our website. To order by mail, send a check with offer number PF-145 to Perry Stone, P.O. Box 3595, Cleveland, Tennessee, 37320. No excerpts of this series will be aired on television or social media, and it is only available through Perry's ministry. We look forward to hearing from you today.
Many of you know that I have been to Israel over 40 times in my lifetime. Most of you are also aware of the fact that in Israel, I would always look at prophetic events. I would research the land, the people, the Bible to discover where have prophecies actually been fulfilled. Prophetic teaching is very important, but it must be grounded not on opinion, it must be grounded on the proper interpretation of the Word of God. I decided some time back to get together with all the prophecies that I knew. Some of them are very vague, you might read the verse and read right over it, not realize how major that verse is. And do a DVD series from my studio on the prophecies that have been fulfilled in Israel in our lifetime, from 48, from 67 and on. 67 was a pivotal date, 1967. So what I have offered to you today is 3 hours of teaching on 2 DVDs, and I'm going to also insert a mystery CD. You won't know the title of it, but you're going to get it as a gift from me for ordering this. Now remember, when you order, you're helping to keep the Manifest program on the air, so please do not forget that. Now there are many things that's getting ready to happen and many things that God is doing in the ministry. We are presently seeing, and I give God the glory for this, only Him, we're presently seeing more people come to the Lord Jesus Christ globally than we ever have in the 47-year history of our ministry. We are seeing such an impact in entire nations. We are on in the Pacific Rim. We are on in the 12 time zones of Russia. We are on in the Ukraine. We are on in Romania, 16 million possible viewers there. And we are interpreted in the language. My program goes and is interpreted in the language of the people there. And yet, with all the people that we're reaching in Indonesia, the Pacific Rim, we have not preached a lot overseas. We stay mostly here in the United States. We are doing the lens of the camera, and if there's any nation in the world or there's a congregation that can hold the people or an outdoor meeting, we can actually sit here and preach live to the people, which we're doing in one nation that has had 120,000 people come to the Lord through our lens of the camera. I also want to say to you that we have spent a lot of income during COVID and during the problems in Israel supporting the Arab Christians, many of them that get no recognition or no help or no assistance, but we have supported Arab Christians in Bethlehem, thousands of families that have been fed and helped as a result of the partners of our ministry giving. We want you to know that we are concerned about believers outside the United States who are suffering, that sometimes they are ignored with all the other support that different people are getting. They're the ones that's ignored. We've been doing that, and we're glad to do that, and we're thankful to God that we've been able to help our brothers and sisters in that part of the world. Well, time is up. Don't forget to go to perrystone.org and get our itinerary and see where we're coming to. Greetings, everyone. This is Perry Stone, and we're about to have the greatest gathering in the history of the Voice of Evangelism Ministry in Cleveland, Tennessee at the Omega Center International. On October the 1st through the 5th, we have our Awaken America event. Every denomination, patriots, Christians, believers from all denominations, you're invited to join me with Mario Morello, Lance Wallnau, Joseph Z, with myself as keynote speakers. Jensen Franklin is coming. There has never been an event held at the Omega Center International like this. October 1, Tuesday night, through Saturday, October the 5th, with Pam's Fall Festival in the evening on Saturday. Register now at perrystone.org.